This video is brought to you by Aura. As you know, energy-efficient storage systems are the conundrum of making the most out of our intermittent renewable energy generation. Now, unless you've had your head in the sand, it's a glaring problem that we have to solve, which is why so many different battery technologies are being explored and developed over the last few years, to the point that some are now coming out of the sand. That's what recently happened in Finland, where the world's first commercial sand battery went live this past July. But how does it work, and is it a viable path for storing energy? Let's see if we can come to a decision on this. Before digging into the sand battery, we should first warm up on some background on thermal energy storage, or TES, which is the technology behind this new invention. Now, if you watch my videos on a regular basis, you've probably noticed that I'm on a bit of a hot streak recently. Now, I've talked about some heat storage before with phase change materials and molecules, as well as concentrated solar power plants. Chemical storage isn't the only option we have to stock up on renewable power. You can convert renewables into heat and store that instead. In other words, you could have a thermal or heat battery. But why should we care about storing zero carbon heat? Well, according to the Energy Information Administration, or the EIA, heating along with cooling and ventilation accounted for 46% of US buildings' energy demand in 2021. Yet this power comes from dirty sources. Over 50% of new American homes still rely on natural gas for space and water heating. Also, based on a recent study, warming up water in houses and offices and fueling low-temperature industrial processes, such as brick and food drying, releases about 10% of US energy-related CO2 emissions. So you can see why developing more thermal storage units will reduce the reliance on fossil fuels, which can also help shrink the climate impact of our heat consumption. So how does this technology work? Well, sensible heat storage is currently one of the most widespread TES solutions. Basically, you heat up a liquid or a solid material by harvesting wind or solar energy during the day or in the summer, when there's plenty of it. Now, the typical way of doing this is to pass electricity through a heating element in contact with your storage material. And to discharge the heat, you simply lower the battery temperature by piping in cool air. Your heat transfer medium can be something as simple as water or more complex compounds like molten salts, which are typically integrated into concentrated solar power plants, or CSP, just like I covered in a previous video. One of the main reasons we need to develop more energy storage facilities is to minimize curtailment for renewables like solar and wind. That's when we have more energy output than demand. A good example of that is when you see wind turbines standing still on a windy day. They've been turned off because there's no demand for the energy that's being generated. As predicted by the Australian Energy Market Operator, over 20% of renewables will be curtailed by 2050. That's why TES systems could play a role in getting us out of hot water. The Sweden-based utility Vattenfall will soon fill up a 45-meter or about 150-foot high tower with water in Berlin. And fun fact, the volume of water sitting in their tank would fill up 350,000 bathtubs. Although I don't think you'd want to take a bath in this tank. Their battery is next to a power-to-heat plant that harvests spare wind energy from the grid to heat up the water to just under 100 degrees Celsius or 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, it's expected to be up and running in April of 2023. Their giant thermos will keep water hot and supply it for up to 13 hours when needed. And this sounds promising, but what if we could clean up our dirty heat by using dirt? Before we get to that though, I'd like to thank Aura for sponsoring this portion of today's video. I had my identity stolen this past year and had to spend a bunch of time trying to fix that. My first indication of the problem was I got a letter from the IRS saying that I owed back taxes on unemployment benefits that I received. But here's the thing, I never claimed unemployment. After that fiasco, I turned to Aura to help protect myself from identity theft and credit card fraud. They provide an all-in-one, proactive online monitoring service that monitors the dark web for your emails, passwords, social security numbers, and then alerts you to any problems that it finds. You can even link your bank accounts to monitor it for unusual spending. It's incredibly easy to use and set up and has a 24/7 US-based support. If you're a victim of ID theft, the Aura team will help you navigate the credit card bureaus to help resolve the issue. Aura is up to 4 times faster than the competition at notifying you of a problem, and all subscription plans are backed with $1 million of identity theft insurance. For a limited time, Aura is offering you a 14-day trial for free. So go to aura.com/matt or visit the link in the description to start your 14-day free trial. They believe that being safe online is a right. Sign up for a free trial today and check to see if your data has already been part of a data breach. Thanks again to Aura and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to this dirt solution. Recently, the Finnish startup Polar Night Energy added a new toy to the heated sandbox, a 23-foot tall or about 7-meter steel silo containing 100 tons of low-grade sand and a bunch of pipes. But they're not using this storage medium to build a sandcastle in the Finnish polar night sky. After running a 3-megawatt-hour pilot in Tampere to heat up a couple of buildings, the startup fine-tuned their design and scaled it up. teaming up with Vaniankoski, which is Kakampa's district heating network operator, and I hope I didn't butcher those names. A larger battery is already heating up local homes, offices, and even a municipal swimming pool, which is serving around 10,000 people overall. And they could replicate this anywhere in the world where you have a district heating infrastructure, just like in New York, Boston, Philadelphia, San Francisco, Denver, Minneapolis. Pretty much most major US cities have one. As touted by Polar Night Energy, their latest battery model could store up to 8 megawatt hours of energy as heat. Aside from the environmental benefits, this storage solution allows the city to save money. Winter over there seems never ending, and Finnish temperatures can be nearly as low as those in Alaska. As you can imagine, the huge heat demand during the long cold season translates into high costs. On the other hand, the sand battery will store clean power during the summer when it's readily available, and then reuse it during the long winter when there's little sunshine. That's why digging into it is financially handy. Nowadays, this would have a higher impact than ever. In fact, after a recent payment dispute last May, Russia froze their gas supply to Finland, so you can probably see why they need a lot of low-cost heat to keep themselves warm. Local governments are pretty pumped on the idea and want to make it 1,000 times bigger. But how did Polar Night Energy turn a sand-filled tank into a heat-storing battery? Well, being connected to the grid, the battery receives excess solar and wind-produced electricity as input. Then this is converted into heat and transferred to the sand. To be more specific, the renewables power a resistance heater, which heats up the air, which is then circulated around the sand through a series of pipes. Now, although it may sound complicated, their heat generation relies on resistive heating, which is basically how common appliances like toasters work. As claimed by the startup, their reservoir is well insulated from the outer environment, which minimizes heat losses over time. Reaching temperatures of up to 600 degrees Celsius or over 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, their sand-based unit could retain heat for months. When it's time to deliver it, you just blow cool air through the pipes inside the hot sand bed. The end result you have coming out of the system is hot air that can produce greener steam for industrial processes, heating public water, or homes. Now, clearly, something as simple and safe as sand to store green power is hot stuff. But how's it compared to other storage technologies? Simplicity is one of the top benefits of sand-based heat batteries. As stated by the startup's CTO, it's really a typical silo, which can be built in any steel workshop. Now, crazy as it sounds, they won't need to build any factories as they scale up. Obviously, they need further components such as pipes, pumps, fans, heating elements, you get the idea. But these are all standard equipment readily available everywhere. Same applies to their key ingredient, which is sand. This is a key advantage over conventional chemical batteries, which rely on hard-to-mine materials like lithium, nickel, and cobalt. Although Polar Night Energy could use any type of sand from any location, the startup prioritizes upcycling the sand discarded in the construction industry, which helps to minimize waste. And that's not the only environmental bonus. As estimated by a third party, Mission Innovation, based on the avoided emissions framework, Polar Night Energy's sand battery could avoid over 100 metric tons of CO2 equivalents per year in 2030. That's almost twice New York City's CO2 equivalent output from 2020. Also, unlike for chemical storage, there's no need for an electrolyte solution to shuttle ions around. And that's a plus as the electrolyte degrades over time and lithium batteries' lifespan is about 15 years at most right now. In contrast, the sand-filled insulated tank designed by Polar Night Energy can withstand high temperatures without losing its heat retention capacity, and as the company claims, it can last for about 50 years. That claim seems very reasonable given the materials and the components that are in use. In addition, while lithium-ion batteries' current sweet spot for cost and energy storage is around 6 hours, the sand battery device is suitable for seasonal storage. Nonetheless, there is a scalding potato cooking underneath the heat-ridden sand. You won't get green electricity out of these devices. I mean, in theory you could. You can use that stored heat to drive a steam turbine, but that would add an extra step biting into the round-trip efficiency, drastically reducing it from 99% to 25%. Now, this is miles away from lithium-ion batteries facing only a 5% energy loss during their operation. So rather than turning it into electricity, it would be more environmentally and economically suitable to use the renewable heat as is. For instance, we could tap into it to replace natural gas-fueled boilers for warming up our buildings. But this would only make sense in cities where you have district-scale infrastructure. In addition, the green P2H solution could also decarbonize heat-intensive industrial processes like steel and cement manufacturing. But I can hear you already. How do heat batteries like these achieve such a high round-trip efficiency? As mentioned earlier, the Polar Night Energy system relies on electric resistance heating, which is 100% energy efficient. Being able to work at temperatures as high as 600 degrees Celsius, sand stores more energy per unit volume than water, which can't go above 100 degrees Celsius for obvious reasons. Now, Polar Night Energy said that their batteries is about 3 times more energy dense than water based on sensible TES. The system would be most beneficial to district heating areas such as some cities, universities, some industrial sites. Basically, anywhere that has an on-site steam plant could benefit from one of these sand batteries, since the infrastructure is already in place. Instead of steam running through the pipes, forced hot air from the sand would travel through them instead. But what about the cost? While sand is dirt cheap, they'll need loads of steel pipes buried inside it, which can inflate the expense. However, Polar Night Energy believes scaling up the facility by 100 times would only increase the price by about 20 times. To be more specific, the startup predicted a cost of about 10 euros, or about $10, per kilowatt hour, once their system reaches a storage capacity of 20 gigawatt hours. And just to give you some perspective, researchers set a target cost below $15 per kilowatt hour when developing new TES systems. Despite Polar Night Energy's estimates being in line with economists' expectations, there's a catch. Their current storage capacity is only 8 megawatt hours, so it will take a while for their technology to be competitive. Now, while sand batteries are not the panacea to a zero-carbon world, they could play a key role in decarbonizing our power infrastructure when combined with other chemical and thermal storage solutions. Rather than idling wind turbines when demand is low and supply is high, they can generate energy for storage in one of these sand batteries. I've said it before and I'll say it again, it's all about picking the right tool for the right job. There's no silver bullet here, but a whole host of solutions. So are you still undecided? Do you think that the sand battery has a chance of catching on? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still To Be Determined, where I'll be discussing some of your feedback. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I have over here. And thanks to all my patrons for your continued support. And welcome to new Supporter Plus member, Silvio Clausen. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.